Hello, everybody. Happy Friday. All right. Welcome, everybody, to another episode of Geering Up Live. If you are watching live, we do have a live chat function. So any questions you have throughout the stream, put them in there and I'll answer them at the very end of the stream. Our co-host today is Violet, so welcome her, and she's going to also help just regulate the chat there. So we're going to start off with a really cool little demo for you guys. So I'm going to show you something. Let me just point the camera towards it. I have two arrows on this card over here, and they're both pointing towards my right. So I also have a glass of water here. It's just a regular glass, just regular water. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to put it in front of the arrows, and I want you guys to observe what happens. Note that the arrows are pointing to the right currently. So we're just going to get the glass, and I'm just going to line it up. Did you see that? So now we can see the arrows are pointing to the left. So they're pointing to the right in the real card. We can clearly see that. But when we put the water in front of it, note, they're now pointing this way. But the arrows on the paper are pointing in the opposite direction. So for some reason, once we put the water, the glass full of water in front of the paper with the arrows, the directions switch. So what caused these arrows to flip? Now, this is what we're gonna explore in today's stream. We are going to explain refraction, and refraction is going to tell us all about why these arrows tend to switch directions when a regular glass of water is put in front of them. Alright, so I have mentioned the word refraction maybe a couple times before in this stream, but what is it if you're not familiar with the concept? In order to understand what refraction actually is, we need to talk a little bit about light. So light is able to move in spaces where there's absolutely nothing. And in spaces where we have nothing, no air particles, that means no oxygen, no nitrogen, absolutely nothing in that space, we are going to call that a vacuum. And much of space, outer space, is a vacuum. There's nothing there. There's no particles to fill it. When we're going in between two stars, for example, much of that space between two stars in our universe is going to actually be a vacuum. However, light doesn't need any particles to travel through. It can travel even if there's nothing, even if we have a vacuum. But we also know that light can travel if we do have particles, and it does go through particles. So for example, on our Earth, we have an atmosphere. So when light travels, for example, from one side of my room to the other side of my room, that light is going to be encountering a lot of the particles that are in the room. So that means there's oxygen, there's nitrogen gas, etc. We also know that light can move through other mediums. So for example, on the screen right over here, we can see that first light is moving through a vacuum, and then we see that light is moving through water. And we know that light can move through water because water is not completely dark if we're outside, for example, in a pool, right? Light can travel through water. Light can also travel through other medium, like for example, crystals. If you've ever had, for example, a crystal chandelier, you know that light goes through it and actually makes a really cool rainbow pattern sometimes. We will talk about that later in the stream. But the point is that light can move through matter. But let's talk a little bit about its speed while it's moving through these different mediums. So when it's moving through a vacuum, that means it's not encountering any particle because there are no particles in a vacuum. And that is when light is going to be traveling the fastest, right? Now we have water moving through, for example, the air. When you're moving through the air, it's going to encounter the particles in the air. For on the Earth, it's going to encounter oxygen, it's going to encounter nitrogen, and those particles are going to slow down the air. So comparative to a vacuum, light in air is going to move slower. Think about water. The particles in water are much, much, much closer together compared to the particles of gas in our air, right? So that's going to slow down the light even more, and it's going to move even slower in something that's more dense like water. So in order to understand this concept of speed and the medium that light is moving through, pretend that you are light. Now, when you're just walking normally, just with the air around you, you can walk fairly fast, right? But when you're walking in water, you're much slower, even if I were to give the exact same effort, right? And that's because you're encountering a lot of particles of water and you have to go against that. So imagine yourself walking in a pool of honey now. Honey is even more dense than water, it's even more sticky. So while I'm walking through honey, it's gonna be even slower to walk through honey. If I'm exerting the exact same effort I was before in the air and in the water, I'm still gonna move slower. So that's because there's definitely more particles in front of me that are more dense and they're going to be stopping me so that I move at a slower speed. That's exactly how light works. So light is gonna be fastest somewhere where it doesn't encounter any particles, and it's gonna be slowest in mediums that are more dense. So mediums are just like water or glass or honey or just anything that light can go through. Light can go through a lot of different mediums. So I hope that makes sense how light and its speed is affected by the medium. So we talked about, why did we even mention this? Why did we mention speed and light? We were talking about refraction before, right? And we did that demo in the very beginning of the stream where we saw the arrows flip direction. So this actually has to do with light moving through different mediums. Let's define the word refraction. So refraction is simply the change in the angle of light once it's moving through two mediums. So I got a photo right over here at the top of the screen. And at the very top, we got air. And at the lower, just the blue part, that is water. And when light is shone onto the air to the water, then we see that the angle is actually gonna change a little bit. And that's because refraction is this phenomenon of light changing angle when it moves through two different mediums. And this is because it's changing speed. So when this light ray was in air, it was going fast, and then you hit that interface of water and air, and then the light suddenly starts to move slower. And it actually causes it to bend too. It causes that angular bend there. And that is what refraction is. Light, usually, if it's not moving through different mediums, it's traveling in straight lines. But when it passes from one medium, so air, to water, for example, they can be forced to bend. And this causes it to change direction and continue on the straight path later on in the water. So this can actually explain a lot of cool effects that we see, and it explains how glasses work actually to fix vision. And we're gonna explore these ideas later in the stream. Note that the type of light that we use is also important. So different types of light are gonna bend to different extents. So for example, if you compare violet light to red light is going to move at a much greater angle once it encounters that interface compared to something like red light. So the color of the light matters in how much refraction occurs, but refraction is going to occur for both of them. So that kind of brings us into the idea of rainbows, right? We know that rainbows are a whole spectrum of colors. We got red to orange to yellow to green to blue to indigo to violet, right? We got all of these colors. So how can we explain the formation of rainbows with refraction? So sunlight isn't just one color. It's not just white light that's purely white, right? It's what we call white light, but it's actually made up of different colors mixed together. And the way that we know this is because we can see rainbows. So rainbows are just colorful curves that appear in the sky when droplets of water split the sunlight into its component colors by refracting the different colors of light to different amounts. So regularly, if we just have the sunlight, which is white light, we're not going to see any colors. There's no refraction occurring. All we see is white light. But we know it's more than white light, right? We know that it's actually a mixture of colors together. And if we get water droplets, and if we put that light through the water droplet, what that water droplet is going to do is it's going to refract the light. But since that light is made up of different colors, it's made up of red light, it's made up of violet light, and we know that different colors of light are gonna refract at different angles, what that water droplet is gonna do is when the light goes through it, it's gonna separate the colors such that when it exits the water droplet, we're gonna see a whole bunch of colors. And that's what a rainbow is. Rainbow is refraction. we typically see rainbows after a storm, right? Why is that? So after a storm, we typically have a lot of water droplets that are in the air that we typically don't have if it's just a dry, hot day. And if we have water droplets just all over the air, when the light goes through it, it's going to refract, which is why we see that rainbow after a storm, because we do have that water droplet in the air that's able to refract it, whereas normally we don't. It's just regular air. There's no water suspended in the air to refract it. So that explains why rainbows are able to form, which is really interesting. We can also see this on a smaller scale. I know that we have this chandelier over here that's crystal, and in the evening when the light comes through, when the sun is setting, there are a bunch of rainbows all over this room. And maybe you've experienced that before. If you own anything crystal and light goes through it, you see that similarly you have these little mini rainbows form. So I'm gonna show you a video right now. And this can be explained again by refraction. So this guy over here, what he's doing is he's getting a prism, so basically a big crystal that's cut into a cool shape. And he is putting white light through it. Again, remember that white light is made up of many different colors. And this white light, once it goes through the prism, it is going to disperse to create a rainbow. And he's just gonna show that in just a moment. So here we go. This is actually a close-up to the light going through that prism and dispersing it into its different colors. And you can see that white light has now become red light and yellow light and orange light and purple light. And that's because, again, we have another interface between two mediums. We have the air, the light is initially traveling through the air. Suddenly, it hits a prism. Now, the prism is glass, so it's a whole different medium compared to the air. And remember, if light travels between two mediums, it's going to have a change in direction. So that white light going through is gonna hit the prism, change direction, it's going to cause the different colors of lights to separate, to disperse, and then once it goes all the way through the prism and again into the air, we're gonna see that rainbow color, and that's what we saw with the video. We saw the white light going through and the rainbow coming out. All right, so we talked a lot about how light can disperse into its different colors if we're dealing with white light because of refraction moving through that glass. But what else can we do with glasses? And why does refraction actually matter? Like, rainbows are cool and all, but how can we relate this to science and to engineering applications that are super important to human life? So glasses are lenses, right? They're made out of lenses, and that means that the light that we see must travel through the air, hit the glasses in front of our eye. Now, suddenly, that light is moving through a completely different medium. It's moving through the glass, and then again, it enters the air once it's through the glass and enters your eye. So there's gonna be some refraction that occurs there because, again, we have an interface between two mediums. We have the air, and then we have the glass, and then we have the air again. So knowing this, scientists have been able to figure out how we can correct people's vision. So let's talk about two different kinds of glasses. You guys might have glasses too, so this will be applicable. So we have two different types of glasses. One of the glasses, we call it a convex lens, and it kind of looks like that. It's just on this side of the screen over here, this one. And basically what it's gonna do is we call it a converging lens. Don't worry too much about the vocab. But basically what that means is once the light goes through this lens, it's gonna cause the light to meet up at the other side once the light goes through. And that's because it changes the angle of the light going through such that they all will eventually meet when it's fully through that glass. We have a different type of lens. Because it's a different shape, it's actually going to refract the light differently. So remember that refraction is not only dependent on the type of light that we use, so the color of the light, whether it be red or whether it be violet, but the shape of the glass, the shape of the medium it's going through is also gonna affect how it refracts. So this time we have the exact same glass as we did before with this lens, but this one is shaped a little bit differently. So it's shaped kind of like this instead of a convex lens. We call this a diverging lens. Again, don't worry about the vocab. Basically though, once this light goes through a lens that looks like this, it's gonna cause the light rays, once they're out, to bend at such an angle, such that they disperse, such that they go out like this. So how can we relate this to our vision? Right, so there are two types of vision correction that you might need. Typically, once people get older, they're gonna have nearsightedness, which or farsightedness, which means that they can see the far, the things in the far, really clearly, but they can't see things up close as clearly. And you might know that if your parents, I know my parents, every time they try to read a newspaper or a book or anything, they need to put on their glasses, right? And that is because they are farsighted. They can't see up close as clearly. And that's because you got a lens in your eye. And basically that lens in your eye is not able to cause the light to perfectly hit your eye at a specific angle. So a way that we can adjust this is put a lens right in front of it. And if we put a lens in front of it, we can correct where that light hits in your eye. And we want the light to hit a specific region in your eye. Now the other type of vision that we have is we got farsightedness, and then we also have nearsightedness. So nearsightedness is typically something that you see in younger people. So nearsightedness, for example, I'm nearsighted. I can see things up close really easily, but things that are further back can be a little bit difficult, so you will need glasses. Again, this is because when the light enters your eye, it's actually not hitting the right place in your eye. And because we can put lenses in front of our eye, that can actually adjust the angle of where the light hits in our eye, and it can correct it. So that's how lenses correct our vision. It's just an application of refraction. So that takes us right into today's demo. Before we do our demo that will talk more about refraction and tell us more about that, let's do our safety check. So today's demo is very safe. Nothing hazardous will be used, not super messy. You don't need to put your hair up or goggles or a coat or anything like that. Just make sure that you perform these experiments with parental permission and supervision, as always. So what are you going to need for today's demo? You're going to need a straw, a glass, and just a cup of water. So let me just point my camera and you guys can see what we are going to do for today. So I just got a glass, the same one that I used in the very beginning of this stream. This is going to be a very short demo, super easy. You guys can totally follow along, and you've probably actually seen this before. It's pretty common. But we're going to get this straw and I'm going to poke it right into the water. And I want you guys to observe what is happening at the interface right over here, which means where the air and the water meet. So if you look at it closely, you can actually see that this straw kind of appears like it's bending, right? So the straw enters the water this way, and you would expect it to follow straight through at the same angle because the straw is not bending, right? This straw is the exact same, and it's a metal straw. We're not able to bend it. But it appears as if it is bent once it enters the water. Why is that? So this is thanks to refraction. What is happening is the light rays are moving fairly fast once they're in their air. And then they hit this interface of water and air. And what happens is that light ray slows down. When that light ray slows down, it's going to bend. And where is it going to bend? As we can see, the straw should have just gone straight like this, but it bent this way. So we can see that the light rays kind of bent like this. And then we can see that the straw appears like it's bent due to the angle of the light hitting. So that's today's demo. Fairly short, super easy. I encourage you guys to follow along because it really demonstrates this concept of refraction really clearly. You can see that the angle of the straw has changed, and that's because the angle of the light has changed in that same direction. So we see the straw appearing bent. Okay, everyday engineering. Let's talk about how we can apply this information that we learned in today's stream to the world of engineering and why scientists should care about the information that we learned today about refraction. So again, we talked a little bit about this in today's stream, but our vision is super important. There are a lot of people who wear glasses. It's very common to see someone with glasses, right? And that's because the lens in your eye or the shape of your eye, something is going wrong and it's causing the light not to hit the correct part of your eye that's needed for you to see something clearly. So biomedical engineers have came up with a bunch of cool instruments and robots that can actually perform surgery, and this surgery can correct your vision such that you don't need to wear glasses anymore. And here you can see a name of an article. It's called Choosing the Refractive Target in Cataract Surgery, and that might be a little bit of a daunting headline, but basically that means that these engineers, these biomedical engineers making these instruments that are needed, and the doctors themselves who are performing the surgery need to understand a little bit about refraction, how your eye typically will refract light because we have a lens in our eye. We have something that's kind of like glass actually within our eye. It's going to refract that light. So they have to understand how your eyeball naturally will refract that light and how we can correct it using surgery. So that is why you should care about refraction. There are medical applications and there are engineering applications with biomedical engineers. Remember, biomedical engineers are going to be involved with the medical field and creating instruments for the medical field, stuff like that. So let's summarize what we have learned in today's stream. We learned, number one, light depends on the medium that it is moving in. So we know that light moves fastest in vacuums, the space where there's no particles. It moves fairly fast in air, even though there's some particles, but it does move a little bit slower if it's going through water or if it's going through glass. Second, we learned that refraction is the bending of light, that change in the angle when light moves through two mediums. And third, we learned that refraction can actually explain many phenomena like how glasses fix our vision, rainbows, and the apparent bending of objects when we place them in water. So we saw this in today's demo with the straw placed in the glass of water. Bending. So it can explain a lot of things that occur that we see in our daily lives, which is why it's important. We have reached the part of the stream where we answer your guys' questions. If you do have any questions, be sure to put them in the chat right now. Now is the time to answer them. And for now, I will answer the questions that have already been asked that my co-host has sent me. So we got a question here asked by Megumi that says, how does it work with contacts because there's no lens? Okay, so contact lenses are actually directly in the eye instead of roughly like half an inch away from the eye like eyeglasses are when you put them on. And because of its proximity to the eye, this zone that's being refracted by the contacts can be made much, much, much thinner than our eyeglass lens. So in fact, contacts are like you have a tiny, tiny little sort of glass, it's not made out of glass, but a tiny different medium on top of your eye that will help refract the light such that it hits the correct part of your eye. But since it's so close to your eye, it's literally on your eyeball, you can make them really, really, really thin. So you don't need that much in order to refract the light correctly. However, with eyeglasses, the reason why they're quite thick, especially when compared to contact lenses, is because they are a little bit like further from your eye. So think of it like this. It's something like looking out of a small window in your house. If you're standing really close to the window, you have a really large, unobstructed view of the outdoors. But if you're standing across the room from the window, your view outside is very limited, unless you have a much larger window. So it's kind of that idea there. If the lens is further away from your actual eyeball, you're gonna need a thicker lens. But if it's on your eyeball, it can be thicker because it will refract it enough since it's a little bit closer. So I hope that made sense and answered your questions. I'll keep looking at the chat to see if there's any more questions. But yeah, this is a really interesting topic in physics about optics. The eye doctor definitely has to know a lot about how this works so that they can give you lenses that correct your vision if you do have faulty vision. So if you want to be an eye doctor, this is something that you're going to have to understand pretty well soon. So I don't see any other questions in the chat, so I'm going to go ahead and end this stream. I had a lot of fun with you guys. So thanks so much for coming today, and we will see you guys on Monday. Bye, everybody.